to the Philippine Benchmark Index. Now, the PSEI records a new year high, closing at 74.58 after gaining 1.3%. Value turnover was at 12.53 billion pesos. Joining us now for her take on today's trade, we have Christina Ulang of First Metro Investment Corporation. Christina, good afternoon.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. Nice to be here.
All right. We have very good indicators today. We are in the 7,400 level, and we are also seeing turnover amounting to 12 billion, not your usual turnover. So what's your take on the current market performance in terms now of price levels, volume, and even sentiment, Christina?
7,500 for the PSA is within striking distance, and there are so many catalysts that would enable the market to easily breach that. And liquidity is improving, and triple R cut 250 basis points has been very helpful, plus the rate cutting expectation both hit and in the US. So those two would be very helpful. Also, the BSP has announced the benchmark pricing for its repo and interest rate swaps would be enhanced, and these are going to be the new basis for loan pricing, and it's going to be improving also the transmission of the policy action in the capital markets and the monetary system. So all of these are helping to improve liquidity, improving sentiment, and of course the foreigners are ever present buying the Philippine market, and HSBC has upgraded us to neutral from underweight. So this all reinforced the positive sentiment.
Okay, now Christina, just a few months or even weeks ago when we spoke, 7.5 was a dream. Now it is within striking distance, so moving forward, the 12-month forecast or the, well, the potential for this market, how high do you think could it go?
Okay, that depends on inflation. We have to see inflation like come out within target. The guidance from Secretary Recto was like 2.5%. And hopefully it drops, and that is going to be like enabling the PSA to like move at higher PEs. We're only at 12, and our neighbors in Asia are at Thailand is at 19, and then Malaysia at 16, and Indonesia is at 30 times. So I'm just hoping the foreigners further buy, and enable the market to move at higher PEs of like even 14 times. Which is still below the historical average of like 15 and 16. So that should suggest higher levels, about 7,500.
Now, Christina, I don't know if you feel the constriction within these levels, but a lot of investors are already saying it may be going up too much too soon. Now, is the upward momentum really sustainable? What do you see?
We're in a new territory, actually, because we have entered the zone of a credit easing rate cutting cycle. So this is the inverse of what we have seen in the past, rate hiking. So this is the reverse. And this is now a new territory, really, for the PSA. So it may not be, it may be okay to have a different mind frame, a different set of strategy in this new era, of credit cycle upturn. That is how I see it. Because the central bank is really very accommodative, and there is more room for further accommodation. Triple R cut is going to be reduced further to 5%. There is room for that in if and when the inflation really sustains to the 2% level. Because if you're going to look at a 2019 episode of rate cutting, the peso was like a 53 and moved lower to 52. And we saw the PSA like move higher, about 8,000. So we are now in the, not really in the same, we are in a more nuanced set of circumstances, but same cycle. And growth is still very strong. And next year is an election year. We know that during election,
GDP spending is also high. Right, right. All right. Now, another question on investors' minds would be, is this the right time to take on riskier assets?
When you say riskier asset would be more of equities in their portfolio.
Equities, more, maybe speculative issues, perhaps?
Issues, okay. So I think it should be there should be a more prudence, of course. Always keep a prudence in your philosophy, and that would be ensuring that your portfolio is balanced, you don't have any over-concentration in any sector. I think that would be the more prudent approach. And bonds would always be there to mitigate the risk in your portfolio. And we're seeing bonds really rally because the yield curve is on a downshift mode. The short end is moving lower, and also the long end is also moving lower. So pricing in all of this accommodation by the BSP, and I think bonds is going to be an important component of anybody's portfolio.
And so if speculatives are not palatable at this time, what about second liners? Is it now okay to venture out of the index? Because we've been noticing that generally and largely, it is in the index stocks that had been growing tremendously, not so much with the growth stocks, though.
Yeah, those are the most liquid. You can come in and out, and you're safe in terms of liquidity, and the foreigners are also taking stock of the large cap. So for safety and for liquidity, best to be playing the large cap, mid caps.
All right. Speaking of sectors, you mentioned earlier you have to be exposed at least in a variety of sectors. Of course, that is still the defensive play talking. Now, what is the outlook now on September inflation? And do you think it will be encouraging enough for the Banco Central to consider an even more sizable rate cut? We've heard the BSP saying it might be 25 by October and another 25 by December. So that's 50 bips more, at least for the BSP this year.
Yeah. September inflation last year was like 6.1. So if you're going to take that into consideration, you immediately have an idea that there's going to be base effect. That's why there's confidence in what Secretary Recto is saying. It could be 2.5 inflation for September. And if that happens, and then we see sustained fall in global rice prices, and then global commodity prices, and even oil, and then we have peso instability, then that creates a lot of room for the BSP to cut. And of course, the Fed is a factor, and the Fed could be cutting like 50 basis point, 25, and another 25. That brings the key rate to like, 4.5. If the BSP is to preserve the 100 basis point yield differential, the clue is that the BSP could be eyeing like 5.5 versus 4.5 of the Fed. But they're saying they're only going to do 2 cuts of 25 each, and that will bring them to 4.75. So that gives me a sense that the peso could appreciate if that's going to be the trajectory of the BSP, just going to 5.75, which means the peso's yield is going to be a lot higher, like 125 basis points higher than the key rate of the Fed. That's going to strengthen the currency. I don't think the central bank would want the currency to rapidly appreciate. So I think Secretary Recto was right in saying that he's going to vote for a 50 basis point cut the next meeting.
Okay, now, Christina, lastly, all of those factors you mentioned, you know, inflation, you have the interest rate cuts, it's supposed to favor the consumer and retail sectors as well. And we're not seeing that much recovery yet from those counters. What is your outlook for retail and consumer in the next couple of months, given that, you know, we're entering the buying season where consumption is supposed to go up?
It's a buying season again. The OFW remittances are going to come in. So more external liquidity, more money to spend, and then the tourists are coming over for the occasion, and that is again another spending source of spending power. But of course, we are concerned about this thing on liquidity. We have a lot of liquidity now. Balance of payments is very positive, and BSP is projecting like 2.3 billion. Mm. So in terms of liquidity, we don't have any problem. So that's a booster as far as your retail and your consumer spending is concerned. And of course, the triple R cut is going to lower the cost of borrowing, and that's going to be like lowering also the interest burden of our households. Although we're not really highly leveraged, the Philippine households have a lot of room to really jack up borrowing. Mm-hmm. And so that inspires a lot of producers, manufacturers, and even car producers like Toyota. And we're seeing very strong demand for cars now.